Once the pandemic is over, will BDA operate as normal, or will it take a while to get everything back on track?
Nothing's ever going to be the same again. This is going to be life-changing. In fact, it's going to change the course of the direction that ABA is delivered in the future, because it's worldwide and we're just in the beginning piece of these crises. In my opinion, we're going to adapt like we already are. We're probably going to be, in my opinion, I think we're actually going to be hiring BCBAs very rapidly in a few months from now in order to serve learners appropriately. I think that the game has changed in the way we may practice behavior analytics services and the delivery, but the growth in an ethical way is going to be very, very rapid. And really, frankly, we're excited about that.
I mean, it's hard to say, right? It's going to be something that we've never experienced before. I mean, we're going to continue to be agile. We're going to continue to be flexible and get us to where we can help learners in a greater capacity than we are now.
I mean, I think it really just comes down to, if you have a child with special needs, behavior issues, whatever it might be, you know, families previously had I'll just call it an 8-hour support of school, or even families with adults that have some disabilities, they had a day program. Right now, schools and day programs are both shut down, so there's 8 hours more of problem behavior. And not only that, you know, teachers and paraprofessionals and our clinical associates, we set up scenarios where we have more instructional control to work through those task demands. And now they're in situations where they're doing home-based learning. So maybe problem behaviors that were happening in the school are now happening in home, and that's an additional stress that gets put on the family. So, you know, just that additional 8 hours with a child being home, even, you know, children that are, I know no perfect child exists, but like, that's still a stressor. We can expect to see, without the supports of, in each state, home clinicians, behavioral health therapists, whatever you want to call them, without their supports, you can anticipate higher rates of 911 calls and police having to come out and provide assistance, going to the hospitals and crisis centers, what Matt was indicating. And, you know, I think a lot of the assistance, whether it be in person, is, you know, great right now if that's possible, but also telehealth, it really can provide a lot of assistance. I think one of the things I learned was a comment that Marlene made one time. I was young in my career, and she said, you know, sometimes as a home practitioner, you don't realize just giving a parent a 15-minute break how much that benefits them, so they can come back refreshed after that 15 minutes. So sometimes just telehealth, allowing the parent to vent to you for 15 minutes, is going to benefit the student, the learner, the son, the daughter. I think, you know, in our guidelines, and this is really Matt's specialty, is in our ethics and everything, but in our ethical guidelines, they define the client as anyone who benefits from the service, not just the student or the learner. So, you know, working with the parents and working with the guardians, whoever it might be, just having those conversations with them through telehealth can, if that's all we can do, is going to reduce their stress so they can more effectively work with their loved one.
One of the coolest things that was done is that in the beginning we had guidelines of gatherings of no more than 500 and then 50, and we are big on generalization of social skills through you know, these congregate groups where we run social skills protocols and everything out in the community. And up until that point, those were still okay by the CDC guidelines. As soon as they clip that to 10, it's like, hey, and non-essential businesses need to shut down, everything like that. It's like, boom, those are done. But instead of saying that our learners can't have social interactions and we can't work on these skills, we changed the mode. And Carol Breslin was huge with this. She texted me and she said, hey, just because we can't meet on site, does that mean we can't go through telehealth? And with all of these telehealth guidelines, having a little bit more flexibility than they used to, I said, absolutely, let's do it. And she ran with it. It was really cool to be able to get these telehealth social skills groups together using Zoom, using Google Hangouts. You know, Brett mentioned that they lifted the HHS lifted the HIPAA guidelines, so you can use FaceTime, you can use whatever for the time being to make this happen, because, you know, confidentiality, protected health information is important, but not as important as other things right now. And I think that's a great move by the government also, taking those actions and making those statements.